And now for something completely different.
Here's what's coming up this hour on Today's Experience. It's fantastic, phenomenal, always fun, usually somewhat fascinating Friday as we head into the weekend. Not being afraid, even if the earth gives way or the mountains fall into the seas, because our help comes from the Lord. First, it's Friday! And it's time for our DDDDDs, four of them if we get there. And they're guaranteed to do whatever it is that God intends them to do. How about that? In other words, that's my way of saying I've prepared them. I offer them before him to use them as he pleases. Basically, what we're saying is it's a Christianese way of saying, let's see what God has in mind. Because we don't always know. Like in the last 30 minutes, completely unscripted. However, these four lessons are, in fact, designed to encourage, strengthen, challenge you and me. And so you still need to buckle up, little campers, because if the Lord says yes, you're going to hear all of them. Now, have you ever heard the expression, there's more to it than meets the eye? People rely on making quick judgments in order to go about their lives in a somewhat efficient manner. However, this means that sometimes they misjudge a situation or they miss the important information that isn't always easily seen at the first glance. Ooh, wow. And finally, we're going to conclude this week's show with a remarkable teaching about the powerful breath of God. No, he does not need mouthwash. And no, it's not bad breath. It's one breath. Because that's all it takes from the Lord to change every moment of everything around us. We often forget that it only takes a moment for a miracle. Because of this forgetfulness, we become anxious and fearful. We need to do a better job of remembering. One breath from God changes the universe because it was one breath from God that created it.
David Spoon's life has been an experience. While growing up in a Jewish family, he made a wrong turn towards drug abuse. Then David Spoon found Jesus Christ, and his life completely changed. The more he studied the gospel, the more he wanted to share his experiences with others. After 35 years of ministry, David discovered a new path of service. He joined KAAM, and this radio program began. You're about to hear the David Spoon Experience.
Welcome to the David Spoon Experience, local, national, and heavenly talk. Here's what else we're looking at during the show. Lessons for surviving, living, and prevailing. Politics, entertainment, and current events. Personal revelations. Spiritual observations. Wow. My life's insanities and oy vey. So much more. Now, remember, as we're getting ready to check in with the dean, remember, it's not professional radio. It's just radio. And we will now check in with the dean, the provost of all authority on radio, our very own Jammin' Jacob. Jammin' Jacob, I ask you today, is the David Spoon Experience professional radio?
No, it is not, David, and we prove that every show.
Every single show we have proven it is not professional radio. Nice job. Very, very good.
Thank you, thank you.
You're welcome. Bottom line is simply this. Here's what we're looking for. We're looking to see how you're doing. We're looking to see what's going on. We're looking to see what we can pray for. Yes, we are aware of the stuff that is going around us, and we pray for that on a regular basis. But we are also aware that each one of us has stuff going on in our lives. So while I pray for everybody in the radio audience, and I pray some generic things, like I pray the Lord blesses you guys financially. I pray the Lord blesses you from a health point of view. I get more specific towards the end of that period when I'm praying, and I ask for the Lord to help you guys situationally. Because there could be things going on situationally that you need help with. And that's not a bad thing. It just means let's take my faith, your faith, our faith, collect it together, and deal with it together like brothers and sisters are supposed to in the kingdom of God. Let us fulfill Galatians 6:2, carry one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. When we do that, we end up carrying each other's burdens, and that helps us in the long run. And then we're also doing what Jesus said when he said, a new commandment I give you, love one another as I have loved you, which is much more intense than love your neighbor as you love yourself, because now we're supposed to love one another the way Jesus loved. And then Jesus said, by this, they'll all know you're my disciples. And it's like, ooh, so it's also a witness because you care for one another. How does that happen? That's God's work. He's the true evangelist. Let him take care of it. Do what he says. He'll take care of it. Right? So the bottom line is, how you doing? If you want to reach out to us, let us know. If you got anything that's along the lines of a praise report, please, by all means, share it. If you got something that's a prayer request, bring it. Let's pray. Let's seek the Lord. If you got something you want to share, something that's on your mind, our gear or our direction or our, what's the thing I'm looking for? Our personality in this show has to do with encouraging one another. We know there's a lot of stuff going on. We support other ministries, financially and otherwise, for the things that they do. We think it's very important to support one another in ministry, and we love that they're doing that. We're just doing our carving, our take, our personality, our drive, our mission, the way that God has set it up for us to do. In doing that, we'd like to pray for people. We'd like to hear about praises. We'd like to share. And we'd like to laugh and also hear bad jokes, which happen quite often. Bottom line, you can reach out to us by sending an email, david@hemustincrease.org. That's david@hemustincrease.org. You can text us live because right now it's live, and at 1 o'clock in the morning it'll be the replay. So that's when it's not live. 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or you can call us. I know. It's a phone. 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. And when you call 972-445-0770, it turns out that you'll initially be talking to Jammin' Jacob. Talking to Jammin' Jacob is like heading into the weekend.
Thank you, David. Happy Friday.
Happy Friday to you. A little slow on the trigger, or did it just not push?
Yeah, I had to hit it a couple of times, but okay. we're good. Yeah.
That's it. Just remember, our equipment here, which is why sometimes the radio goes out all over the place, our equipment here is right before Barney Rubble moved in with Fred, or moved next door to Fred Flintstone. So if you just remember that, that will really help you out, okay? Okay, that's – here's a better joke. Ready? Our equipment's so old. It's as old as when the Dead Sea was still sick. There you go. Come on. Don't tell me that's not funny. You guys know that's funny. All right, we also do Bible trivia. Here's your Bible trivia question. Who said this? Your answer is going to be in John chapter 18, 37 and 38. Who said this? What is truth? I always imagined it with an accent. Sorry, that's how it's going to go. Who said, what is truth? John chapter 18, verse 37 and 38 is your direct reference point. If you think you know, you can reach out to us, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. Who said, what is truth? You can also text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. Or you can send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. Who said, what is truth? Here's your big hint. Somehow connected to airplanes. That's it. That's all I can say. In the meantime, we're going to do our DNA. That's right. That's all you're getting. D stands for draw closer to the Lord.
Daily.
Every day. And you know what the thing is? If you make it like a grudge, like it's a harsh thing, like a discipline, like if you don't like shaving, but I got to shave every time. If you make it that way, you're giving that kind of life to it. Don't do that. When you come and spend time with the Lord, it should be the delight of your day. It should be the highlight of your day. What do you think is going to happen in heaven? You understand what I'm saying? It's like you've got to have this attitude. I've got to have this attitude. We need to have this attitude. This is a privilege laid out by the blood of Jesus Christ that we can spend time in communion with God. I mean, just think of that. Would you just for a second? How he sets it up through the blood of Jesus Christ, through the sacrifice, how he made in Hebrews 10, 19 through 22, how he made a new and living way so we can access the Holy of Holies anytime. Look forward to it. It should be the highlight of our days. Draw closer to the Lord daily. D. And never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. Never be ashamed. The world will try to shame you. Here's the answer. Don't receive it. They have no heaven to put you in. And the only reason they're going to try and shame you is because they're ashamed that they don't know him. Never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. Luke 9, 26. And then finally, the A. So you got D, N, A. D, draw closer to the Lord daily. N, never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. A, always be ready.
To serve.
To serve. Ready? On God. Be ready. Get ready. Try it for just even a couple of hours a day. Try to just get out of it. It's all about you and your universe and think, what can I do, Lord, to serve you, to be used as a vessel by you? Or we used to do this thing in the very beginning of our show, that 10-second prayer you'd start the day off. How can I serve you today, Lord? We did a count because it was like 8 or 9 seconds to pray it if you took a really long time. How can I serve you today? How can I serve you today? It's a great thing to start your day with. What if the Lord just, you know, wants you to pray for somebody, bless somebody, encourage somebody? Maybe he just wants you to listen to somebody. Just starting your day off going, how can I serve you today, my King? Right? That's always being ready to serve. So D, draw closer to the Lord daily. N, never be ashamed of Jesus or his words. A, always be ready to serve. Your trivia question, who said what is truth? Your hint, this is somehow very closely connected to people that fly airplanes. There you go. Get that? 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483 or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org, to our first... Oh, wait, somebody's calling. I had a feeling that hint was going to help people. You see that hint was very helpful. You get that? Who said what is truth? I think that's a good way to kind of set it up. All right, so I think we do have somebody that's ready to answer. Are they ready to answer the trivia question? Let's send them on through. Knock, knock, this is David. Who am I talking to? I'm sorry, who's this?
Charles Edwards.
Charles, how are you?
Yeah, it's been a little bit, but I wanted to answer that question.
All right.
You didn't have to give me a hint. I already knew that, but yeah. It's pilot.
That is correct, Amanda, sir! That is very good, although I think some people would think, hey, that was a good hint. Like who flies the airplane?
The last time I was on, I was like, okay, what? Okay, I couldn't hear it.
Good job, brother. Very good job. That's the way to bring it home. I just thought that would kind of loosen up the thing, though, and help people get there. So that's what it takes. Well,
I'm out today running some errands and stuff, and I turned on your radio. Wanted to listen to you.
Thank you, brother. I hope this next thing's a blessing. This is a good teaching coming up, and I hope I can communicate it well for you.
Okay. Thank you.
God bless.
Okay.
Bye-bye. All right. Great job. Boy, we're just rolling today. Here we go. 2 Kings chapter 6, verses 15 through 7. The title of this DDD is There's More Going On Around Here. Ready? When the servant of the man of God got up early and went out, he discovered an army with horses and chariots surrounding the city. So he asked Elisha, "Oh, my master, what are we to do?" Elisha said, "Don't be afraid, for those who are with us outnumber those who are with them." Then Elisha prayed, "Lord, please open his eyes and let him see." So the Lord opened the servant's eyes. He looked and saw that the mountain was covered with horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Oh, come on, man. What that servant saw was in the natural. He saw the armies that were coming against Elisha, trying to take him down and trying to take him out. And what he saw in the natural freaked him out. Yes, I know that's not the normal minister language. I don't care. It did. He was like going, "What? How would you like to wake up and go outside your tent or your home and see an entire army camped around you, ready to go at you?" That's what he saw. And so what happens? He's like, "Uh-oh," right? No room here, right? So he said, "Oh, my master, what are we going to do? There's nothing here. We're in big trouble. Look at this situation. Look at this circumstance. It's the size of an army." Want to know why? Because it was an army. And it wasn't just a small army. They were surrounding the city. If it was surrounding just a tent, you could even make an argument it was small. That's not what it says. He discovered an army of horses with horses and chariots surrounding the city. This is a big group of people, a big problem, a big issue. What are we going to do? That is what we go through. We go through some encounter. We have a situation. We have an army that's surrounding not just our home, but our city. It's large. It's big. It's impressive in the sense that there's that show of force. You know it's right there, and you can tell. This is a big deal. And he's like, "Oh, my goodness, what are we going to do?" Elijah's first response, right? Don't be afraid. Don't you find it interesting that on all of these situations, even when John was getting the revelation, even when these different things take place, where in Jesus, after he resurrected and he saw the disciples, don't you find it interesting one of the first things that always comes up when people are freaking out is Jesus saying, "Don't be afraid," is God saying, "Don't be afraid," is the prophet saying, "Don't be afraid." We always have to be reminded of that because we often give in to fear. Why? That's part of the old us. Part of the old man. And so the first thing Elisha says is, "Don't be afraid." And then he says this, "Those that are with us outnumber those that are with them." And you just know that guy at that moment's thinking, "What are you looking at? That's not what I see. What are you seeing?" What did Elijah do? Then Elijah prayed. In prayer, prayer is the prayer game was for perspective, for a clearer vision to see better. Elijah prayed, "Lord, open his eyes and let him see." The prayer for perspective was answered. By the way, that's an excellent prayer for every one of us in our circumstance, to pray for God's perspective, not ours. Why? Well, we're supposed to walk by faith and not by sight. And when you do walk by faith and not by sight, you see a little bit more of what God's doing. Here's the result. The Lord opened the guy's eyes. He looked and saw the mountain was covered with horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. True vision and insight for his eyesight was revealed. Let me say that again. I want you to catch this. It's a great little thing. True vision and insight was given to his eyesight, and it was revealed. And at that moment, there was no need to be afraid. God is large and in charge in that circumstance. Isn't that great? Oh, it's just awesome. It's phenomenal. All right, we'll take a short break and then come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
Hey there, it's Amazing Jennifer, and I am helping out the David Spoon Experience. As you may know, I basically run the KAAM radio station.
Amazing!
And Dr. Dave is looking for a few good people to join and become representatives, ambassadors, and stewards of this here radio ministry. Now, you may be thinking, well, I'd love to get involved, but I'm not very qualified for ministerial positions. Well, the truth is that because you are a child of our Heavenly Father, that you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you seek to live by the power of the Holy Spirit, you have all you need to be a part of this ministry. But Jennifer, don't I need to be perfect? No. Just go to hemustincrease.org. That's hemustincrease.org. Click on the three lines at the top right of the website, and then click on the Ambassadors Initiative link. Just fill out the form and we will reach out to you. But sorry, no parking tickets will be paid for you as an ambassador through this position. You are on your own with that.
It's incredible, and it's never been done before. And you can be the first person in your neighborhood to win.
What is it?
It's a contest.
How do I play?
It's simple, and there's three ways to win. You can go to Facebook, type in David Spoon Media. And on any Facebook post, type in the word Jesus in the comment section. And it's free. You can also send an email to davidspoonmedia@gmail.com and write the word Jesus in the subject line. Or you can go to YouTube and give a comment on any video. But you have to use the word Jesus. This is your chance to win, and it's free.
What do I win?
You can win 100 thank yous right on air. It's incredible. It's unbelievable, but it's only for a limited time. Enter now. Here's a taste. Thank you for listening to the David Spoon Experience.
What is the David Spoon Experience?
John 7:24, stop judging by mere appearance and make a right judgment. That's all good. For 1 Corinthians 6:2, do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if you are to judge the world, are you not competent to judge trivial cases? You can't say Christians can't judge. They're commanded to. Here it is right here. Ready? Here's the bowling ball knocking down the pins. Every day as Christians, we have to judge what is appropriate, proper, healthy, and useful. Also, what people we believe we should hang out with, trust, believe in, or let influence, we have to judge that on a regular basis. When you choose your church, you're using your judgment abilities.
Bazinga.
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 Bazinga. I love that. Because listen, when you're choosing your church, you have to decide to pick one over another. Oh, here's the key. You're going to hate me. Ready? Here it is. If we have no ability to judge, we can't vote. Welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas, where right now the trivia question is about to be stepped up in terms of difficulty. Get ready. Who said, this thing that you have conceived in your heart, you have not lied to men, but to God? Who said that? This thing that you have conceived in your heart, you've not lied to men, but to God. Who said that? Acts chapter 5, verse 3 and 4. Acts chapter 5, verse 3 and 4. If you think you know the answer, you can reach out to us. 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. Additionally, you can send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. Who said this thing that you have conceived in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. Acts chapter 5, verses 3 and 4. Who said that? If you think you know, you can reach out to us. In the meantime, I've got a teaching that I want to kind of jump into. It's amazing. I get to jump into another teaching. Such a rarity. But wait, yet somebody's calling, so not quite so fast. I can see the Lord going, you thought so. See, I have this thing. I know people don't have this. They have a much different concept, and I don't have any problem with that, but I just think God's funnier than you guys think he is. I mean, have you looked at the platypus? I mean, it's just so you look at it, you go, okay, why'd you make that? Okay, here you go. Somebody is ready to answer this. Is that terrible that I say stuff like that? All right. You got to love me, because if you don't, then you're in trouble. I mean, whether I'm your neighbor, your enemy, or your brother, you don't have a lot of choice. Okay, let's send the person through. Knock, knock, this is David. Who am I talking to?
Hi, David, this is Michelle.
I'm sorry, who is this?
Michelle.
Michelle, how are you?
I'm good, thank you.
All right, you ready for this one? This is a good one, right? Because it's you got to think about, you know, the whole situation. So I'll set it up for you, and then I'll let you kind of knock it out of the park. Here we go. Who said, why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You haven't lied to men, but to God. Who said that?
Absolutely, it was Jesus.
Okay, now, well, now, in Acts chapter 5, when the two people weren't telling the truth, and they were lying about how much they gave. Remember that in Acts chapter 5? The Ananias and Sapphira situation? Do you remember that? That's, then there was an apostle who said that to them. It's all right, just come walk with me, you'll be fine. So there was an apostle who said to them, why did you conceive this thing in your heart? You haven't lied to men, but to God. Who did they say that? Who said that to them? Which apostle said that to them in the early church? If you were to guess... All right, let me give you this one. Part of a band, blank, Paul and Mary. Do you remember that band? Okay. How about who was a pumpkin eater? I'm going to help you get there no matter what. Okay. How about, because it's blanky, blanky, pumpkin eater. Is that ringing a bell? All right, I'm going to help you. Ready? It's Peter. Peter said... Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You've not lied to men, but to God. And he said that to Ananias and Sapphira, who were lying about what they gave. But you are still... That's what it is! That's okay, because you technically you're right, because Jesus was speaking through him, so that was good.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's the Apostle Peter when he goes, hey, you're not lying to men. Okay, maybe he used a little bit of a slang. Hey, you're not lying to me. You're lying to God. You know, it's like, what are you doing? And they got in trouble. And that was Ananias and Sapphira in Acts chapter 5. Is that ringing a bell?
No.
Okay,
no.
That's fine.
I thought it was Jesus.
That's everything behind them is Jesus. Now, do you remember what happened to Ananias and Sapphira after Peter said that? What happened to Ananias after he lied? Do you remember what happened to him?
Oh, now I remember. Those are the two that dropped dead for lying.
That is correct, Amundo. You are right. You got there. That's what happened. So they lied, and then Peter's like going, okay, bad call, bad call. It's just like, and what was
it? Right. I'm so sorry. Definitely. For sure. Oh my gosh. I remember. It hit home with me because in the sense of, because the Lord, how we love the commandments of God, and before we love the commandments of God, we're liars and everything that breaks the commandment of God. And God, which and Jesus and God were showing me, that they don't like that. And when I saw it in the scriptures, I was like, wow, the seriousness of lying, that God hears, the Spirit of the Lord hears when we lie, even if it's a little white lie. And it's when they taught me not to lie and how to love the commandments, and if you love God, then you will love me. If you love me, then you'll love the commandments. You'll do the commandments. And when he taught me not how to lie, it was that serious for me, even the little white lies. And so now when walking with the Spirit of the Lord, the consciousness of the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord, when you have these situations come and you're like, oh, man, a lie would be good because they don't need to know that, you know. It's like, you know what? If you can't handle the truth, then get out of the kitchen.
Just handle it like that.
You got to handle it like the truth, because the Spirit of the Lord is watching and listening, and you'll be honored. You'll be honored by Him by doing it, and in the meaning of you're moving in obedience.
Yeah, and that's it's an important point. And let's remind you another thing. In Proverbs it says there's six things the Lord hates, yea, seven, and two of those, one of them is a deceptive tongue and another one's a lying person. It's like, those are like the same thing. And it's like, well, so two of the seven are God's going, yeah, being a liar, that is not a good thing. And then they get into Romans 3:4, let God be true, but every man a liar. It's like, in essence, only God is perfect in that realm, which is why we depend on the grace. But our goal should be very clear, and that is just to speak the truth. And if you can't speak the truth, you're not able to, don't make up a lie. Just be quiet. just don't say anything. Yeah. You don't have to say something and get in more trouble. It's the words that get people in trouble in the first place. So that's very good. Good job. Way to come back on that one. Nice job.
Oh, wow. Well, thank you. God bless you. And thank you so much for what you do. It's so amazing to hear you on the radio and really bringing into remembrance the Word of God for us and those that are studying, too. You're just amazing. You're just set apart from everybody else. And I just thank you so much.
Well,
God bless you.
This is more fun for me than work. The work part's the driving. The work part's all the other stuff. This is the fun part. Because I just love the Word. So it's just one of those things. I just like love the Word. I look forward to the prayer. But I appreciate you saying that. And, you know, I have my equal, if not greater, problems than everybody else. But I also have an equal, if not greater than a lot of people, understanding that God loves me in spite of my goofy. And so I'm okay with that. I'm good with that. Great. Very nice call, and I thank you very much for it.
Thank you.
All right. God bless you.
God bless. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Okay, so we're going to take our break there. See, I thought I was going to teach. I don't know what I'm talking about. We'll take a break and then come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
What is the David Spoon Experience? Imagine yourself on a rocket ship racing at 1,000 miles an hour into space. Once there, you can sense the power and the presence of the majestic and the divine. You forget about your troubles and your fears, and you just float in peace without a worry in the world. There are no struggles, no pain, no discomfort. It's soothing, calm, comfortable. But then, the show starts. And you realize that none of that stuff has anything to do with the show. What were you thinking? The David Spoon Experience. Only for the brave of heart and the bored.
What is the David Spoon Experience?
Bibles are very cool looking. You can have them electronically. You can have them in your phone. You have them in your computer. There's tons of apps. There's also cool looking book Bibles. I mean, there's a lot of stuff out there. It's great. Here's the bottom line. All that's fancy and fantastic and useless if you don't read it and believe it and process it. For those that are trying to figure out, first of all, well, why is it that the Bible is its own unique entity? What's the deal in that? Well, the same breath that went into creating Adam, which was creating creation of man, that same breath went into the Bible. And so 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is God-breathed. And that's the breath of God. And the breath of God that went into Adam is the breath of God that goes into the book, which is why this is a unique book. And then people are get really upset, and they go, well, hold on now. Hold on now, Dave. The problem there is, you know, that there's just so many people that have been a part of writing the Bible. In fact, there's about 40 authors spanning about 3,000 years in all different types of positions in life. But here's the great thing about Christian faith. If you believe that God created the universe, you're going to step out on that big ledge and go, well, if he created the universe, he can probably write a book. Well, the amazing part about the book itself is not just the self-proclamations of the book, but you get into the prophecies, and it's an amazing, amazing element that every single prophecy has been fulfilled exactly, and yet there are some to come, and we will see those fulfilled. But while you're engaging in the Word of God, here's something you need to be aware of that Christians do not recognize. That word where it says, for the Word of God is alive, is zone in the Greek. If we were doing a Greek word, that'd be zone. And that word means alive, to live. Jesus used that word in Revelation chapter 1, verse 18, where he says, behold, I am alive, and I live forevermore. Same word. And the Word of God is alive. And you think, well, this is just a book. It is just a book, except for when you're reading the Word of God and the Holy Spirit connects you to the Word of God, it becomes something altogether different. Welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Little easier trivia question coming up here. How many chapters are in the Gospel of Mark? Your reference point, ready, is the Gospel of Mark. Like how I did that? How many chapters are in the Gospel of Mark? How many chapters are in the Gospel of Mark, if you think you know? 972-445-0770. You can also text in 214-210-8483. Additionally, you can send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. So I want to lift up a couple of things in prayer, and then we will get on to sending you to the website. But let me do this in prayer first. We want to pray. So we've been praying for Will, and we've been praying, and I'm going to give him a chance, actually, if he wants to call in. But we've got some good news that's going on there, which I'll share towards the end. We also want to keep praying for Roslyn and Robert as they continue in their pathway. They're just looking to do what the Lord wants them to do. And that, of course, is a good thing. And I'd really like you guys to take this on. Just listen to what I'm going to say. So there's a lot of people in the audience that have they're struggling in relationships. And it's not just marital relationships. It's friendships and everything. We talked about this just a little bit the other day. Just sometime this weekend, I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask. In fact, I'm going to put this on you guys. Because you got to share. We got to share the burden. Okay? We need to be praying for one another in relationships. That's what we need to be doing, because prayer is a big component on people that have estranged or difficult relationships. So I'm going to pray that, but I'm asking you to be a part of that. And then we do have somebody who's ready to answer a trivia question, but let me start with this first. Father, we come before you right now. We thank you and praise you. We just acknowledge you. We thank you for Will. We thank you for his wife, Dee, and for their mother-in-law, and for the graces that you're pouring upon them. We look forward to hearing the testimony that's come forth from there, and we just are so excited for your gracious hand in Will and Dee's life and in their mom, mother-in-law. And we're just so thankful. And Lord, we lift up Rosalind and Robert to you. And we ask you, Lord God, to give them such a great unity of mind and peace that they know the directions that they're taking, the steps that they're making, are the best they can before you, and that they would entrust their circumstance, the rest of it, and how it pans out, into your hands, and not be fretting, but be trusting. And Lord, for those of us in this audience who have relationships that are strained, that, Lord, us who are going through that, we would not be discouraged. That we would not be discouraged, but that we'd be encouraged. Because you have always proven yourself faithful. And you've even shared with us through your very own kids how you bring about redemption even 18 years later. And we ask you, Lord God, as you have brought redemption to mankind, that you would bring redemption in some of these very tough relationships. And that your mercy and grace would prevail in them. And the spirit of forgiveness would be dominant. We just ask for your help. You're so merciful to us. Help us to be that way as well. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Okay, our trivia question. How many chapters are in the Gospel of Mark? We do have somebody on the line ready to answer the question. Let's send them on through. Knock, knock. This is David. Who am I talking to?
God bless you, David. This is Frederick.
Hello, Frederick. How are you, my brother?
I'm doing fine, sir.
Awesome, awesome. You ready? I'm going to set it up for you. Let you hit it out of the park. Here we go. You ready?
Go ahead.
How many chapters are in the Gospel of Mark?
David, there are 16 chapters in the book of St. Mark.
That is correct, Abundo!
And I want to accentuate just one verse. It's one of so many verses. But I just want to just for a second just accentuate one verse. And that is Mark chapter 7, verse 37. And it says that God does all things well, but actually God does all things perfect. When he saves you perfectly. When he delivers you perfectly. Whatever he does it in the best way possible.
That's right.
And to his glory.
Yes, that is a great, great message. Never think that God does. That's one of the great, great truths, that God does it perfect, not partly. He doesn't do anything. He's not saving you a little bit. He's saving you all the way that the salvation needs to be done. It's like in every
entirely.
That's exactly right. Great, great word, my brother. Great,
God
great
bless
word.
You.
All right, my brother.
I'll hang up.
God bless you. Bye-bye.
All right.
There we go. All right. I just you love that. See, you should love that. I love that. And here's why. Because God doesn't, he's like, you know, now we say God is good and that's fine. But what Fred is bringing about into play or into our minds, into our hearts is, understand this. God doesn't do kinda. God isn't kinda with you. God isn't kinda for you. God isn't kinda love you. Okay? That's kind of like the same lines of, well, she's a little bit pregnant. It's like, no. She's either pregnant or she's not. I mean, it's not overly complex. And God is like, he is there for us. He is with us. He makes a commitment in Matthew, the first chapter of Matthew, and in the 28th chapter of Matthew. So in the beginning of the Gospel of Matthew and at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, he says, I'm with you. I'm with you. Matthew 1, what is it? Emmanuel, God with us. Matthew 28, I am with you always. He's always with us. God doesn't go hang out on Pluto. He's hanging out where you are. You just don't always know it, and neither do I. And he doesn't save you a little. He doesn't answer. If the Lord does the healing, I just want to say this, and I'm going to get in trouble for this, but it's okay. God doesn't heal partly, unless the Lord had some specific thing where he says, I'm doing this for this, and I'm going to leave this for this. Unless he says it that way. And God does the fullness of everything. So I'll just bring that in. When Paul got healed from his situation when he was prayed for, he didn't get partly healed. Just remember that, okay? God doesn't do anything. Well, I'll do it a little. So stop. Would you a little love your kid by feeding him a little food? Okay. And if we know it better and we're evil, as Jesus said, how much more reality checks in for us when we get into the other element? That's just like, isn't that just like amazing? All right. Let me. I got to do all this stuff quickly. So just bear with me. Okay, I'm going to do this very short teaching. It's really cool. Just hang out. Okay, it's called One Breath. Exodus 15, 9 through 10. The enemy said, I will pursue them and catch them. I will divide their wealth and take all I want. I will draw my sword and take all they have. Verse 10. But one breath from you, Lord, and the Egyptians were drowned. They sank like lead in the terrible water. This is so good. Listen, Exodus 15, 9 and 10. The enemy said, I will pursue them and catch them, referring to Israel. I will divide their wealth and take all I want. I will draw my sword and take all they have. Verse 10, but one breath from you, Lord, and the Egyptians were drowned. They sank like lead in the terrible water. So on one side, you have the arrogance of the enemy, the people who are against God. I will do this, and I will do this. I will do this. I will do this. I'm going to catch them. I'm going to steal from them. I'm going to wound them. Yeah, that's it. I'm going to do it. But verse 10 says this one really interesting word, but. In the earlier dictionaries of the Webster, before they did the merger, the word but means on the other hand. And listen to this. On the other hand, one breath from you, Lord. You know what it takes for God to change your universe? One breath. You know what it takes for God to create the universe? One breath. You know what it would take for God to change your circumstance? One breath. Now, I'm just going to use this as an illustration. It's not a perfect illustration, but it is hilarious. And I saw it, so you can't say it didn't happen, okay? George Foreman fighting Michael Moore in 1994. So just so you can know, that is approximately 04-14-24, 30 years ago. And Michael Moore was pummeling George Foreman. All the way, just playing every round. I mean, George Foreman's face looked like a Cabbage Patch Kid. And for one moment, in the ninth or tenth round, George Foreman threw one punch. And Michael Moore hit the deck. And then George Foreman became the champion. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. It only took one punch to change that entire circumstance that I watched on boxing. It only takes one breath from God to change your entire circumstance. Think about that. One breath! And it's all different, right? All right, we'll take a break and then come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
What is the David Spoon Experience?
For this is the kind of high priest we need. Holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He doesn't need to offer sacrifices every day, as high priests do, first for their own sins and then those of the people. He did this once for all when he offered himself. Now watch this. Oh boy, this is so unbelievable. Jesus is a unique kind of priest. He is your high priest. He is so unique. And you think, why? What is it that makes Jesus unique? And you already know, well, it's because he's, you know, born from the Holy Spirit and he's born from Mary. So he's fully man, fully God. And it's like, okay, I get that part. But there's something else that we miss quite often. And that is Jesus is undefiled, separated from sinners. And verse 27 says he doesn't need to offer sacrifices every day like the high priests do, first for their own sins. So let me explain this to you. When priests or petitioners or people are praying on your behalf, every human being has to deal with their own set of sins. It doesn't matter if it's the high priest of Israel. It doesn't matter if it's the high priest 1 year, 20 years later, 40 years later. There is something that takes place. It's the same dynamic that takes place when you spend time with the Lord and you come before the Lord and you thank him and you recognize the grace of God enables you to stand, because apart from that, the grace, apart from the mercy, apart from the love that comes from the Lord and the redeeming work from Jesus Christ that you receive by faith, that he gives by grace, apart from that, you're a mess. And so when you come before the Lord, you're like, Lord, you know, please forgive me. Please don't be mad. Please, you know, don't chasten me. David said it great. Don't chasten me in your hot displeasure. I don't want to get you irritated. Na, 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 na. You see, when Jesus comes and petitions for us, he doesn't have to go through that. He doesn't have to be centered on himself to be forgiven, because there's nothing for him to be forgiven. He's sinless. He doesn't need to offer sacrifices for what he's done or for any of the lacking that he would have if he was a regular human priest. So when Jesus comes on our behalf, there's nothing. Get this. Here it is. There's nothing distracting him in his life. He is only focused on our well-being. Welcome back to the David Spoon Experience. Thank you for joining us here at KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. That's KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. I'm going to give a quick shout out to Brad. Brad's asking a question about locating a Bible without chapters or verses. So, Brad, if you're hearing this, I'll probably text you as well. But there is a Bible called the Bible Without Chapter and Verses, the Holy Bible, the Old Way for Old and New Testament. You can probably get that on Amazon, just to let you know. There is, but it's called the Bible Without Chapters and Verses, the Holy Bible, the Old Way. Okay? Just trying to see if that, I hope you get that. All right. We try to help people in a lot of different realms, folks. That's what we do. Here's your last trivia question. You need to think about this. Our time is down to 5 minutes. I know you guys can get this done. Who said, well, why wasn't this ointment sold for 300 pence and then given to the poor? Huh? Why wasn't it? Now, you already know it's not one of the better disciples, so that should help you. Why wasn't this ointment sold for $300 or 300 pence, sorry, and given to the poor? Who, which disciple of the 12 asked that question? John chapter 12, verses 4 through 6. John chapter 12, verses 4 through 6. Who, which disciple would do that? Oh, my goodness. Good job, Jeanette. Somebody ready? Are they answering the trivia question, or are they just calling in? All of it together. Okay, it's got to be Samson. All right, it's a joke. Okay, let's send the person through. Knock, knock, this is David. Who am I talking to?
This is not a joke. This is Samson.
How did I know? Aren't I good?
We are the soul brothers.
You can just tell. It's time for a call. It's just classic right there. Let me set up the trivia question. We're only down to about 4 minutes, so we got to keep everything on pace. Which disciple, not one of the better ones, said, why wasn't this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? Who said that?
Okay, I'm going to give you an indirect answer.
Okay.
The replacement of the Matthias.
What? Okay, that is correctamundo, sir.
Yeah,
that
Judas.
Is your indirect. That is a right. Right. Exactly. And it's just like, and the reason he did that, he said that not because he cared about the poor, but he cared about the money because he was holding the money bag. It's like, well, if that's not a pre-runner to American politics, I don't know what is. Anyway. Oh, they care about the poor, do you? Well, yes, and my new Maserati.
Like our Social Security.
All right, brother, we got 3 minutes. How you doing?
I have a quick prayer request. Pray for me. I'm just feeling a little stressed. So
yeah.
Just pray that God will just release that stress.
Okay,
yeah.
Let's pray. Father, sure. We come before you right now. I lift up my brother Samson. And Lord, it's this guy, he's got a lot going on and a lot floating around him. And when that happens, Lord, there's a lot of wind and a lot of waves. But Lord, he has a capacity to let that go just by believing that you have this purpose. You have this place he's going to get to, this destination. And in that destination, in that process, Lord, he can be at peace. That doesn't look the way he wants it to look now, and it doesn't feel the way that he would prefer. But using his faith, connecting to you, he will not only prevail through sorrow, but through trials and through obstacles and things that stand in his way. The water will not come above his neck. He will get through because you are with him and will not leave him alone and let him drown. We just thank you for that and pray you would encourage him and give him courage. And we ask you to bless him and his family and love on them. Hug them by the power of your spirit for all of us on our behalf. And let him know that comfort and that grace. Let him walk in that comfort and grace. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen. Hey, also keep me in your prayer. Tomorrow I'm doing a funeral for one of my patients. They didn't have a pastor, so I'm doing their funeral. So just that God will use me to glorify him even through that funeral.
Okay, everybody in the audience, that is your responsibility. And my friend, my brother Samson, go.
Tomorrow at 11 a.m.
Do it before the Lord with all of the humility but confidence that you have. You'll do great. You hear me? You'll do a phenomenal job. I want the audience praying for you, okay?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everybody. I love you, and I'm praying for you all as well.
All right.
God bless. And Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom, brother. God bless you.
Bye-bye.
All right.
God bless.
Bye-bye. All right, folks. Now, look. Next week, okay, well, I can't really talk about that right now. Here's the bottom line. I want you to go into this weekend and not have a sense of dread. I want you to go into this weekend and lift up your faith and say, you know what, Lord? I'm going to do it. I'm going to believe you so that when you pray, you will receive. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be full. How about that? But you're going to have to use faith to do it. All right, folks, you've been listening to the David Spoon Experience right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas, taking a 70 and one half hour break. Then we'll come back. More Insanity with Spoonanity. Talk to you then.
The views expressed in the preceding program were those of the speakers and not necessarily those of KAAM, DJRD Broadcasting, or its sponsors.